Hello people, welcome back to my channel. So today is the very first video of deep learning and neural networks. So I have got many of the votes from the poll which I have put 2 days before for deep learning and neural networks. So I decided that I'll be starting with the deep learning and neural networks. So welcome to the first lecture on deep learning and neural networks. So this is a very general introduction regarding what will be a neural network and what is deep learning and why we require in today's world. So I have made a couple of few videos before in my machine learning videos. In that playlist you can find a video called as artificial neural networks. So that is a predecessor, or you can just consider as a prerequisite for this particular course or for this deep learning. So I'll just put in the description below, you can check that video out, or I will put that in the cards up, so you can check that. So in that I have discussed a few different concepts and how it just looks like and what are the different mathematical functions it's there. So there is also an implementation that we'll be doing in TensorFlow. So that will not be held in the current times, but after a few months, since I'm also doing practical hands-on on that, so it takes time. So just for the time being, we'll be having a few lecture videos on different concepts like activation functions and some delta rule, chain rule, differentiation, partial derivatives and so on. We'll be dealing with that. And later we'll do some practical hands-on on TensorFlow and other like PyTorch or whichever is comfortable. So let's begin. So today's video is regarding the deep learning and neural networks. So you can consider in what way you like, whether it's neural networks or deep learning. I'll just give you a general idea of what these things are basically. So this particular topic in deep learning and neural networks, so this topic is not currently being developed, or so this is there from a few time before. So in the early 1940s and 50s, these things were there. So, but at that time, we did not have the hardware or the machine which we currently have. Since in the today's world, we have high computing machines and different hardware with different configurations, different solid state drives, DDR3, DDR4, different systems like gaming PCs and laptops. At the old time, we did not have that high computing power in order to carry out this particular activities. So in the older time, if we remember, we had this punch card systems where for typing different instructions or different carrying out different sequential instructions, we used to put that punch cards. So in today's world, that punch card is equivalent for you to write a program in R or Python. So you can consider in similar way. So we have evolved and come across so many years. So now in the present times, we have this hardware and system so that we can do these things more efficiently. So to talk about the very first picture or the very first notion of a neuron or a neural network came from the biological neuron from the human brain. So this particular idea of generating these kind of systems came from the biological neural network. So you have the human brain, different kinds of axons and dendrites, synapses, etc. So that's another topic for biological neural. I will not go into the details of this biology of how the human brain works, but that's just another topic. So just the idea of this neural network came from this. So to talk about the very first neuron was put forth by MCP, that is you have McCulloch and Pitts neuron. So they have put forth a neuron in order to check whether these neurons can implement simple Boolean gates. So we have this AND, OR, and different gates like that. So what we basically have is we have this unit. So we don't call this as a neuron, but we just coin this as the term unit. So what we'll basically give is we give two inputs, x1 and x2, and this particular unit is consist of two parts. First you have a linear part and then you have a non-linear part. We'll come down to the line why we require these two different parts and why non-linear part is most important in neural networks. So this linear part is essentially a summation. So where you have all these inputs, you multiply with some coefficients and you just transform this. And here what you have is a step function. Just for the time being, we'll just consider the step function. And what we have is, we have output, say y cap. So what I've said is, I have some things here. So these are essentially called as weights. So what you do is, when you just put into this system, it will just produce the multiplication. So it will have w1 x1 plus w2 x2. So now your input goes in this way. So it is the product of sum of all the weights and the inputs that is going to the system, and it will just convert into some form, into some step function form, and it will produce the output. So w cap is w1 x1 plus w2 x2, and you have some terms here. So now essentially this particular equation is not new to you. So we have already seen what is linear regression and what are the various components in that. So this is essentially y is equal to mx plus c. So c in this case is considered as a bias. So that is an external configuration we apply. So that's not a part of your neural network. Just for your understanding, say you have b0 or b, and with bias also you have some weight w3. So essentially you can consider this. So your x remains the same, but your m is replaced by this w's. So these are essentially your weights, or you can call as coefficients. So whenever you do linear regression, those are called as the slopes, but when you consider neural networks, those are called as weights. So essentially with this, what you have is you get an output. So that is called as the predicted. And then what you have is you have the actual output y. So what you do is y minus y predicted square, you do the sum of squared errors. So that gives your error, or it is also written as j, that is the cost. So this j stands for Jacobian. So j is essentially a function of your m and c. So that we saw from linear regression. So essentially here also it's a function of your bias as well as your weights. So weights and bias. So essentially what we do is we have a, now we have obtained an output, and we compare it with the output we already have. Now if there is a huge difference in that, then what we try to do is we just go back to this particular neuron, we adjust these weights. We will not touch our input. So input is in our original form that we desire to give to our neural network. So what we do is we are changing these weights. So essentially whenever we are constructing a neuron or in neural networks, we are learning weights. And so if you remember, we have a, when we did gradient descent, so what we essentially had is we had some parameter. So that is called as lambda. So these are nothing but the learning rates. So we want to learn this particular weights so that our error that is produced at the end is minimal, or it converges to zero, but it cannot be always zero, but it can converge to zero, that is approximately equal to zero. So this is our end output that we want to achieve. So the current world, or after this MCP neuron, what we currently have is we have the perceptron. So perceptron is the most advanced neuron that we basically work on. Obviously in the real world, in today's world, what we have is we have Google Inception, and then you have Microsoft ResNet, that is residual network, neural network. So these are the two most prominent neural network that is used in today's world. But all of those have the origins from the perceptron. So in perceptron, you add a bias, you try to improve your function, and which acts like your C, that is your intercept. So this is the main thing, or is the key point when you have to construct your neural network. So this is nothing but your This B is nothing but your intercept, which you just adjust your slope so that all the instances can be linearly separable. Now, what they did is, since their target goal was to implement a Boolean gate, so what they started with is, they had this AND gate. So we have x1 and x2 and y. So when we have both 1, you get 1, 0, 1, you get 0, 1, 0, you get 0, and 0, 0, you get 1, 0. So if we want to mimic this particular Boolean activity in terms of neural network, what we basically do is, we draw one neuron or unit. You have x1 and x2. So now here I am not considering any weights. So essentially this would be summation of all of this. So you can consider 1 and 0. So any combination would produce your output. So it will give you any of this function, that is y. So what is the part here, that is the non-linear part, that is greater than 1. So if it is greater than 1, then you have to fire this accordingly. Then what you have is, you have this OR gate. So in OR gate also, the scenario is similar, but here you have this, whenever you have 1, that is 1. And so in this case, 1, 1, it's 1. 0, 1, it is 1. And for this, it is 1. For 0, 0, it is 0. So your neural network just changes, like you have greater than or equal to 1, and you have x1, 1, and 0. These are the two inputs that I'm providing, and I have y cap. So till this portion, they could implement it perfectly. But what is the problem with this perceptron is that these cannot implement the XOR gates. So how XOR gate looks like is, you have y predicted. So if both the inputs are 1, then it is 1. If it is 0, then it is 0. Else, it is 1. If both the symbols are same, then you trigger a 1. Else, in the other case, you trigger 0. So they cannot, or they could not implement this particular functionality, or they could not mimic this particular thing in kind of this perceptron. So this was the major challenge that was there in the older days. So in order to understand this geometrically, say you have these two instances. So instead, say like you have two of these planes, and say you have two classes. So for positive, I'm considering a triangle, and for zero, I'm considering a circle. So now what happens is that you cannot differentiate this between a linearly separable line. So there cannot be a hyperplane that is possible to separate these instances. Or in fact, if you have 0 here, and if you have, this would be perfect. So you cannot separate this by drawing a linear line. So what they essentially did is, they just projected to a higher dimension. So what they did is, they constructed a hyperplane, and they could essentially separate these two instances by having different orientations of this plane in that space. So now by adjusting this different hyperplanes with the help of this bias, so now this bias comes into picture where you can adjust this hyperplane. So by this, they can change this or just make this linearly separable, which was not in the case of two dimension, they could achieve in three dimension. And so this neural networks or artificial neural networks are also called as universal function approximators. So whenever, if you have two instances or n number of instances which are not separable in lower dimension, then it is projected to higher dimension. So this power of, from where the neural network can just project the points or space to lower dimension to higher dimension, comes from two theorems in mathematics, and those are called as Cover's theorem, and the other is called as Kolmogorov theorem. So from these two places, this neural networks are called as universal function approximators. So you cannot see this kind of approach in any other algorithms that we have seen in the machine learning, like decision trees or singular value decomposition or any other techniques. So that's why this neural networks are also called as the black box machines. So assume like I have this setup. So I know this is a very bad example to show, but say these two are inputs that is going to this neuron. So consider this as a unit or a neural unit, and this is the output. So whenever you pass on this two, you don't know what's happening inside. So it is a black box. So you are so you cannot see what is there. You have these two idea of like these two inputs are going into the system and you get some output in response to that. So you don't know what's happening inside. So but in case of other naive bias or decision trees, what you can see is those are white box machine learning algorithms. So you know what is the thing that is, or how the machine takes a decision in producing the output. But in case of neural networks, you cannot guarantee like what is happening inside. So essentially, these kind of neural networks cannot be deployed onto productions, like for predicting stock or for giving loan to a particular customer or for providing drug to a particular patient. So then that becomes a very questionable scenario, like on what basis you provided that drug or predicted that particular thing. So then it becomes debatable. So often in that case, you don't go with this neural networks, but instead you go with some other machine learning algorithms like SVM, or you consider the naive bias or decision tree in order to perform that activity. So well, this was all regarding a gentle introduction regarding deep learning neural networks. And so you have many more topics coming with this, like you have the activation functions. So I have not talked about the nonlinear part, so that will be considering in the activation functions. You have many activation functions, then you have the gradient descent, then you have the delta rule, chain rule, etc. That will be coming in the so forth coming videos. So well, that was all regarding a general introduction regarding the deep learning and neural networks. So hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you got educated watching this video, please do like, share, comment, and if you're new to this channel, please consider subscribing. Thank you very much for watching this video.